invited to join me. We're going to do some different affirmations throughout the month of October. And this is 880, the 19th degree. It's a little longer, but I appreciate your so. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, the God of Almighty, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit, Bartholomew was honest and true.
Jesus loves a pure heart. Bart would say that to you. Yeah, that's him. James was very quiet with not a lot to say, but he served Jesus well and he lives with him today. Yep. Thaddeus did what Jesus said without quitting, always helping people. You'd never see him sitting. You think that's him, Blakely? Let's see. Yep, that's him. Thomas didn't always believe what Jesus said. Faith was in his heart, but doubt was in his head. Which one? Let's see. Yep. Simon was excited about Jesus' teaching. He would sit and listen and then go out preaching. Think so? Judas was a man who went his own way. He didn't stay with Jesus even on his last day. Yep. Peter talked a lot about many things, what's right and wrong, and the joy Jesus brings. Matthew loved money and always wanted more until he met Jesus. Then he left it for the poor. James was little, but he gave his very best. Being a disciple was one exciting test. Can y'all be disciples? It says, a disciple is someone who learns something from a teacher, then helps other people learn it too. You can be a disciple by learning the things Jesus taught, like love, forgiveness, and trusting God. Then loving and serving others the way Jesus did. Then you will be one of the dudes who did. Y'all want to be a dude who did?
No.
Yes, you do. You want to go and be one of Jesus' disciples?
No.
Yes. Well, you can be a girl who did. How about that? All right, who wants to say our prayer this morning? Anybody? Okay, Miss Barbie will say it. Dear God, thank you so much for this day and for these precious children and the families they represent. God, help us to remember to be a disciple for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right.
Chisholm, Joanne Hargraves, Bill Jackson, Tim Thomas, Lee Scarborough, Charles Harris, Steve Burke, Shelby Sims-Cora, John Johnson, Billy Moore, Bobby Dubock, Kenneth Guest, Ruby Morrow, Miranda Rocca, J.C. Southward, William Warren, Nathan Turner, Chuck Yonke, Terry R. Sullivan, Kinsley Helton, Ruth Cope, Beth's sister-in-law, Jim Schaffhauser, Julia Shelley, Angel Galvin, David Hill, Eric Hoyt, Lanny and Delia Travis, Winston Turner, Jimmy Miller, Rose Hoskins, Carson Hoyt, Mary Ellen Hennard, Sharon Smith, Dini Duffel Schaefer, Sawyer Weems, Claudia and David Newcomer, Faye Dinsmore, Ashley Woodyard DeBolt, Judy Bellamy and Debbie Gordon, Earl and Agnes Whitson, Gary and Melissa Muscal, David Treadway, Renee Pace, Louis Acock, Carolyn and Mary Wilkinson, Linda Moten, Angie Fannin, John Arnold Schaffhauser, Lisa Marie Grundling, Prue Jake and Bree Hefner, Lisa Ross, Sutton Wood, Glenn and Deb Hosey, Carrie Davison, Clara Bass, Jimmy and Betty Davison, Brenda Woodyard, Bonnie and Curtis Petty, Stephanie Powell, Walter and Tanya Varner, Sherry Westcott, Sue Lester, Betty Jo Hall and Judy Jody Lambert, Mary Kay Bird, Carolyn Sue Campbell, Lyndall Smith, Joyce Summerhill, James Jackson, Lauren Jackson Garner, Ann McFarland, Stephen Jones, Johnny Turner, Bill Brown, Robert Dennis, Dale Tyner, Dale Webster, Laurel Coker Catlett, Dale Barworth Womble and family, our continued prayer list, and the family of Richard, David, Blush, and Little Rock. Any other prayer requests?
A friend of mine fell and broke her femur. So Karen Stanfield.
Karen Stanfield. Anybody else?
I just say from the Lexington Church, I like to lift up Butch, Bunny. Uh-huh. I just say he's got some things going on. He's got some travel going on, so he must be great.
Okay.
And I have a friend who was a parishioner of the, his name's Goodman, Larry Goodman, and he had congestive heart failure and had some other issues that are going along with that. He's my number one compadre when it comes to being a Chiefs fan, uh-huh. So. Larry's a really good guy. It's one of those things that you talked to me last night. So.
And our prayers of Thanksgiving. Lee Scarborough got a good report from the doctor but can't start walking until October 15th. Gilbert and Sylvia Hall are doing pretty well and send their love. Congratulations to Kaylee Holloway, Tri-County Fair Miss Congeniality and first runner-up. And congratulations to all of the fair winners. Any other? Yes, thanks to Brian, who's always helping.
Right on.
Yeah. Anybody else?
Did she say?
Oh yeah, Brooklyn is here. It's one of them.
About being late, but you know how it is with all the paperwork that we've been trying to do. You would think with a church with one member that we'd be able to get all that done, but I don't understand all that anyway. But I appreciate David sort of blind me trying to figure out, hold it down, hold a light on it, so he's able to sign the paperwork. So you can imagine that we have Butch and Julie and Miss Ruby Jean with us today, and I'm always grateful to be able to have any kind of conversation that goes on like that. I apologize about being late and quit this morning, but trying to get that back on schedule. But I apologize. Last week was kind of close as well. So as we go to prayer this morning, I want to glad to have our new equipment to be able to do that. I apologize. I didn't have that set up for us when we got here. So. Looking forward to a great, I hope that everything went well at the fair. Kim's been under the weather. Somebody had passed her a bug or something this morning, so she's been dealing with that, and a sore throat and everything. So she's not with us today, so I'm going to kind of lift her up in our prayers as well. So, I'm Tom Mullins. I'm the pastor of Baldwin United Methodist Church, and I'm so glad and welcome you to here this morning, both here in person and online. And dear gracious and heavenly Father, we come to you this morning thanking you for the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives, we pray for those that are on our list, but we also pray for those that we have on our hearts and minds, that they would be lifted up to the healing power that comes from on high. We thank you this day as we come into your house to worship you, that we are here to worship you with our whole hearts, minds, and souls, and we just thank you for all of the gifts and blessings that you bestow on our lives. We thank you for the ideas and the imagination to be able to be ministers out in a world that's fallen and is hurt. We just thank you for all that you do for us. We ask for your presence to be with us on this World Communion Day as we think about those all around the world that we're sharing in communion, remembering the atoning sacrifice that he gave us from the cross, and the hope of resurrection and the hope of eternal life that comes from knowing you as our personal Savior. Bless this time together, bless this day, and thank you for being our God. And in your name we pray. Most holy and gracious God, on this World Communion Day, as we think about your sacrifice, as we think about you, for all of the great and wonderful things you do, help us to give and to give cheerfully in a way, in a manner that we are builders of the kingdom of God because of the power that is behind us, that power of the Holy Spirit. Bless these gifts and thank you for being our God. In your name we pray and we ask all of these things. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Preparation show 398, fill my cup, Lord. Yes, it's so good. It's really great, but...
Our scripture today comes from Exodus chapter 17, verses 1 through 7. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do for these people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you at the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it, so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
I think this is an unusual Sunday in some ways. It's one of those things that I grew up in a tradition in a church that did not serve Holy Communion either once a month. It was once a year, and it was the beginning of Holy Week. On that Sunday evening service that they would have that. And not only did they have communion, but they had foot washing, which is one of those kind of extra ordinances or extra sacraments that a lot of churches, we have special services for them and stuff. We've adapted it to make it more politically correct, so now we pour water on people's hands and do some different things because there's something about ugly feet that we just as Americans don't like, right? So it's like, it's one of those things that we're embarrassed by that. Maybe you should take better care of them and all that kind of thing. But the remarkable part about it is communion to me, once I became a Methodist and once I started going pretty regularly to committee meetings and all the kind of stuff that they do to you when you first start at the church. It gets you on all the boards and all that different kind of stuff. Teaching the children and all the kind of busyness that you have with that. It seemed like everywhere we went, they were lighting candles and having communion. It was like I just had never seen that so often and so frequently. But I've come to know and come to love and appreciate that. I have heard preachers and different ones. Our district superintendent, Blake, he up there in the northwest part of the state, he told and had a whole sermon on about communion, how he had come through communion to know Christ and to become saved in a manner that was a part of that. And if you listen to the words, a lot of times a lot of the stuff like the Lord's Prayer, the Apostles' Creed, and the different things that we go through, those kind of those motions, and we forget the meaning behind them and different things. I had one church that actually, I had asked them in a service if they would give me an affirmation that we would do the Hammond Church, the Hammond United Methodist Church, we would do an Apostles' Creed type deal or a creed from them. So they the little pieces of paper, I got all of it for the next couple of weeks, I got all these pieces of paper. So I put that together, and then they had it framed in their church. They had a creed that came from their hearts and their personalities. During confirmation, a lot of times we'll do that. We'll do the Apostles' Creed. So you think about the words that you're saying, about being, one church and the different things that go along with that. And it's pretty amazing. I think communion is so vital and so important to our communion as far as our fellowship, and it's all that type of thing. I was always amazed by communion in the fact that before I became a United Methodist, it was one of those things that I feared it. Because it says that you're supposed to have the right heart and the right mind if you're going to come to the table, the Lord's table, and all those types of things. And the penalty, I thought, would be very grave if I went up there and didn't have the right heart and the right mind to take communion. And I think that it's amazing that when we celebrate, that we have an open table. It's one of those things, you don't have to be a Methodist, you don't have to be regular attendee or whatever it might be. If you have that relationship and that growing relationship, communion can be a part of that, and I think it's very important. The message that I wanted to give today and talk about our scripture that we read, or that I read, is about being half empty and half full. I read the story of Tom Sawyer. Some of you may know that and may have heard that before, but Tom Sawyer was told by his Aunt Polly that he had to whitewash the fence. Tom was unhappy since he was planning to go fishing with his friends and didn't want to have to paint the fence. But Tom did what his aunt asked, and he began to whitewash the fence, you know, just kind of lackluster and all that kind of thing. But then after a few, you know, a little bit of time had passed, along comes Huck Finn and the other boys. And they're jiving, and they're saying, oh, look, you get to go paint the fence. We're going to head out to go to the fishing hole and all that kind of thing. And they were carrying their fishing poles, and they were giving him a hard time and all that kind of thing, poking fun, that he had to work while they had to go off and have fun fishing and doing that kind of stuff. As they passed by, Tom took their remarks, he took them in stride, but then he got a chance to reply. He says, you know, it ain't every day that you get to paint a whitewash a fence. It's like, it's so much fun. Tom turned a chore that had been one of those things that from being a chore into being something special. A few moments later, he had all of these boys helping him paint the fence so he could get it done with all of that type of thing and done. What Tom Sawyer did was to make the chore of whitewashing a fence something positive instead of something negative. Instead of agreeing that it was an arduous task or a hard task, he made it into something that his friends would thought would be fun. And by working together, they were able to get it done fast and quick so that he and them could go and go fishing and do their stuff. Tom did, what he did was approach his chore with an entirely different attitude from the negative that it had started out to be into something positive. When the Israelites complained to Moses that they had no water to drink, Moses was backed up in a corner. It wasn't like he could create water from nothing. The people were criticizing him for bringing them out into the desert and then allowing them to run out of water. Moses, however, believed that somehow they could make it and did not buy into their negativity. His people saw only thirst, but Moses saw that there was help that would come from God. Their complaint did not cause him to doubt that God was with him and the presence of God was there. Moses asked God for help. God told Moses to strike the rock at Horeb with the same rod that he had struck the Nile and turning it to blood, and he did just that. And as a result, water came pouring out from the rock for the people. Moses, with the help of God, had turned a tough situation into a positive one. Moses sees the whole situation differently than his people do, than God's people do. He knows God has brought them through thick and thin and from far and will take them all the way to the end. Although God had helped the Israelites before with water, bread, and protection from the Egyptians, and they had seen the miracles that God had performed. They had traveled through the Red Sea. They had seen all of that, but still they were negative. Moses, however, knew that they had encountered such obstacles before, the things that happened to them, and that they had overcome them with God's help. His perception is different from the people, and all they want to do is complain, criticize, and whine. So in Scripture, you hear a lot about stiff-necked people. I hate to mention it, but the fact is we are still some stiff-necked people in God's church today. It's amazing to know we have that experience, but we still don't really trust God a lot of times to handle things. In this case, a negative attitude is an expression of unfaith. Had the Israelites believed, as Moses believed, they would have had confidence in his leadership and what God could do for them. But all they could do was find fault. That is why Moses named the place Massa or Meribah, which means complaining and all that type of thing. It was not Moses the people had the problem with. It was God. God had intervened before, but they still complained. They failed to make the connection that God would help them. All they had to do was ask. Just as God had done and helped them in the past, he would help them in the future, today and in the future. How often would God have to intervene before they started to believe and started to ask God for their help? One wonders whether the Israelites thought of being in that kind of chaos,
And I'm sure that many of you know people who just, if things are going really smooth, they just can't handle it. They just do not want to be a part of, you know, the everyday and the kind of that. There has to be some kind of upheaval. There has to be some kind of crisis, something that brings attention to them and the situation. And that's kind of the way these folks, or it was the way the folks of Israel were as they traveled. This was an oppressed people who were in bondage to the Egyptians, and now they were free. Freedom means different things to different people in different parts of the world. When I talk to my African and European friends, it's like they talk about, when we say freedom, they say that, well, that means you can do anything you want to do. And that's what they talk about, freedom. But what it is we in the church should know that there's a different definition of freedom. Freedom is that you also, with your privileges and all the things that you can choose to do, there's also responsibility. And that's the difference between when you are truly free is when you take on the responsibilities and you do what God wants you to do, and God will help you manage to do the most, what seems otherwise impossible. But it's those people that are there that cannot stand for that static or that regular, everyday kind of things, that when things are going smooth. And just like the Israelites, those people are the same way. When God led them across the Red Sea, but now they seem to have lost their faith. Since they now face another crisis, they figure that God had deserted them. Is God with us, or isn't he? They ask, and they ask Moses that. Is he here, or is he not? The wilderness that they were in was not just the wilderness or the physical wilderness around them, or the desert. It was that in their mind. It was one of those things that they were lost in a state of mind that they just seemed, they just couldn't appreciate what God had done for them. When life threatens our comfort zone, we tend to lose a handle on reality. In other words, we fail to see the big picture. When things aren't going the way that we want them to go, because all of a sudden we get angry. That's when you notice those people around you, when things aren't going their way, they're not as pleasant as they are when they're going their way, right? During seminary on a Friday afternoon, I was trying to restore my computer. I had been working all week or for a couple of weeks, and it just went into cyberspace. I lost my paper and everything, and I was just crazed. I forgot to eat lunch, and I just kept messing with it, and I was so involved with it. We have just become so dependent on computers, and I have become so dependent on mine, that I was forgetting other things. I love it it's interesting to me when the tower goes down, or when the power goes out. All of a sudden, when we can't have those little boxes in front of us, and we can't see any pictures in there, and we can't talk to those people that we've been talking to all day, and the people that we've been talking to across the one cubicle to the next, and different things. But I had spent probably about 4 hours, and finally I just gave up. I can't do it. I just have to figure something out. So I'll still go home, finish up what I have to do here, and then maybe I can come back to it later. But I waited too long to get help during that time and stuff. So you know how it works at school. You can get extensions and different things. And I was hoping to do that. I finally got a tech and a tech that actually helped me. It was pretty amazing. It's our human nature to question the presence of God when things go wrong, when we perceive a situation in a positive way rather than a negative. God becomes more real to us, and life does not seem to be so overwhelming. A colleague tells a story about a certain man who went to church on Sunday. He frowned when the organist missed a note. He glared menacingly at two whispering teenagers. He looked repeatedly at his watch. When the offering plate was passed, he felt the usher was watching to see how much he gave. He sat tight-lipped during the hymn singing, and during the sermon he felt pleased with himself when he caught the preacher making a slip of the tongue. As he sneaked out the side door during communion, he muttered to himself, "That was a terrible service. Why do I even bother?" Meanwhile, another man went to the same church on the same Sunday. He chuckled at the sight of the father exchanging hugs with the toddler. During the offertory, he wondered, "If God has given me so much, am I giving enough?" He struggled honestly with the scripture readings to find a word to live by.
Part of the sermon helped him with a question he had had on his mind. He enthusiastically joined in the singing of the closing hymn. As he left the church, he thought to himself, how good it is to be here in God's presence with all these wonderful people. Both men had gone to the same church on the same Sunday, but each one of them came away with a totally different perspective. And it was their attitude that made the difference. Today, you might be saying, well, it's a beautiful day outside. On the other hand, others might be saying, well, it's a little chilly. I wish it were warm. Or it's the opposite of that. I could say I have now lived half of my life now that I celebrate my 55th birthday. Or I could say, on the other hand, I could still say that I have half of my life in front of me. When the Israelites complained to Moses, he did not get defensive or argue. Instead, Moses asked God for help. I believe more people would have a cheerful outlook if they weren't so stubborn and they would ask for help. For me, there is a direct relationship between asking for help and believing, as Moses did, that God would provide. Why is it so difficult for us to ask for help? Unfortunately, we live in a society that has taught us to be independent and self-sufficient, telling us to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps, which is actually a physical impossibility. There's no way to do that. But it is realistic to think that we can get along through life without anyone's help. It's unrealistic. That is not the way that God has designed us. From the very beginning, he knew that Adam needed help, and that's where Eve comes. They were helpers for one another. Moses asked for help, but God did not do all the work. God told Moses to gather the elders, strike the rock with a rod. Moses had God's help, but he still had to do something. Getting help does not mean we are off the hook. We still have to do something. We have to act. There was a man who was complaining to God he never won the lottery. And I'm sure that you've seen on TV that there's about $1 billion lottery out there. He prayed and prayed that he would win. And he was outraged with God. He said, I can't win. When God told him, son, if you want to win the lottery, you first have to buy a ticket. And the same is true of getting help in any situation. I said earlier that I had a problem with a virus on my computer. I needed help, but waited too long to get it. I finally called a tech who helped me. He came and fixed the problem. I know with certainty that God is with us. And sometimes I fail to acknowledge him, and that I need to humble myself and ask for God to help me. Just like Moses did, I have to do something. What I find amazing about this story is that God intervened and gave them water to drink for the Israelites. The Israelites complained repeatedly, but God still responded. The fact that God brought forth water from rock is symbolic of the fact that God showers grace upon us when we need it, not necessarily when we deserve it. God wants us to believe in God's intervention. God wants us to have a cheerful outlook, because then and only then do we have faith in him. God wants us to humble ourselves and ask for help when we have a need. It's not so much, it's the complaining, it's not the asking that gets us into trouble. And God constantly pours grace upon us, even when we least expect it. The word of God. World Communion Sunday. I just want to mention that again and know that you are more than welcome to come to the table. There's no fear in knowing and asking God for help and being a part of God's kingdom in this way. And I appreciate it so much, very much. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him to earnestly repent of their sins and to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and one another.
Yeah.
good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, to praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church to deliver us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, and he broke the bread. Gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a living, as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is God, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and with peace in his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now with the confidence of the children of God, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Most gracious God, we thank you for the Holy Communion, that we are a part of that communicants of Holy Communion, and knowing that we are your disciples. We ask for your blessing as we remember your death and resurrection and the hope of eternal life. Bless us and keep us as we go forth to see. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we are proud to be a part of the communication that is the Holy Eucharist. We thank you for your blessing upon us, as we are blessed to know that you have sacrificed yourself for us, that we might have the hope of eternal life. Bless this time together that we fellowship in this way, coming to your table. Help us to go forth to serve with love and care for one another, and to do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father, we ask for your blessing upon this time together, and we are so proud to be part of the Holy Communion, as well as the World Communion. We just thank you for your many gifts and blessings, helping us to remember the sacrifice that you have given, and the fact that we are our resurrection. We have the promise of resurrection and eternal life only because of you. It's in your name we ask, and we do all of these things as we go forth to serve, to love, and to care for one another. And do it today. The Father, the Son, dear Holy and Gracious God, we thank you for Holy Communion. We thank you for the fact that you, on this day, as we recognize those people from around the world that share that communion with us, knowing that we are a part of the kingdom. We ask that you help us to remember to reach out to those around us, to love and care for them in their time of need, their time of loss. And we lift up the power of your Spirit, the same Spirit that you have come upon us. And we ask and do all these things in the name of Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. For our hymn of invitation is page 413, a charge to feed by a
Thank you.
Most gracious and holy God, we thank you for this time together as we celebrate communion, as we think about the choices and the things that we do to help us to go out into the world to be your disciples, to transform our world and community by relying on you and asking for the help that we need when it comes to doing those things that are needed. Bless us and keep us.